Next session will be the speech of locomotion and sleep in children with developmental disorders. The speaker is Dr. Yoshiko Nomura. The interpreter is Tang Qingming 医师。Let's welcome Dr. Huisheng Wang to give us introduction.
Thank you. 我还是讲中文哈，来介绍一下我们这位野村医师哈，他是跟我一样是小儿神经科的领域的一个很 outstanding 的学者。那他是在日本毕业，ECN 毕业之后，那就去美国接受了很严谨的小儿科训练哈，两年在 Mayo Clinic。那另外两年在纽约的那个 pediatric neurology 的那个专科的训练，然后回去之后，他就在Chicago Neurology Clinic， 这个先生已经走了哈，不过当那时候他是一位很 outstanding 的学者哈，他的名字留在我们儿科一个很重要的疾病哦，叫 Chicago disease， 赖川氏症。那很厉害，那个病如果没发现哦，那小朋友大概一辈子没办法走路。那赖川教授跟诺莫拉先生就是他们发现的，用一个很简单的药，不像今天要用那个什么4900万的针才治得好，一个很简单的药就可以帮这种小朋友完全解决他的问题。好，那 Chicago Neurological Clinic 因为 Chicago 先生的走掉之后哈。然后我们的诺莫拉先生就自己出来自立门户，他设立了一个 Yoshiko Nomura Neurological Clinic 在东京啊哈。那今天诺莫拉先生要跟我们讲这个很重要的题目 ，locomotion， 讲白一点就是擦地板了。我在台湾一直在推动擦地板运动，但是台湾的家长都觉得擦地板就给了的啦哈，但是日本小孩从小就要擦地板。所以他们解决了很多 locomotion 方面的问题，还有睡得不好也很有关系的哈。那我就介绍到这里为止哈，谢谢。
Good morning, dear colleague and friend. At first, I would like to extend my heartfelt appreciation to Wang John Young's Social Welfare Foundation organizers, Dr. Wang, Dr. Lin, and members of the child neurology community for inviting me to this important.Meeting of Early Intervention International Conference. Thank you very much for the kind word. Introduction to Dr. Wang. My title today is Locomotion and Sleep in Children with Developmental Disorder. Locomotion is a coordinated movement of arm and legs.
各位亲爱的贵宾及同仁们早安。首先我想向王瞻样社会福利基金会主办单位王辉雄医师、林光林医师以及儿童神经医学界的各位成员们表达衷心的感谢，谢谢你们邀请我参加这场早期疗愈国际研讨会，非常感谢刚才王辉雄医师的介绍。今天我所演讲的题目是发展儿童的动作能力和睡眠。
I received a line message from Dr. Wang early in January of this year. It said that in August, we are organizing a symposium of early intervention of children with developmental delay.
王辉雄医师在2024年的1月17号传来给我，他说，我们预定2024年的8月10号到8月11号举办发育迟缓儿童早期介入的研讨会。
Our conversation continued. Dr. Wang said, I encourage children kneeling down to wipe the floor, as many Japanese did, to improve their locomotion. Do you have time to come and talk about the efficacy and popularity of wiping floor in Japan?
王教授提到，我鼓励孩子们跪下来擦地板，就像许多日本人一样，以改善他们的动作能力。你有没有时间过来谈谈日本擦地板的功效和普及程度呢？
I answered, Dear Dr. Wang, kneeling down to wipe the floor is a daily activity of us as school children after finishing class before going back home. It was one of the discipline and autonomy of old Japanese, which might have gone with a bit.
野村博士提到，亲爱的王教授，跪下来擦地板是我们儿童下课后回家后的日常活动， 这是可能会随时间而逝的旧日本人的纪律和自主性之一。
Dr. Wan said you could talk about the mechanism and anything academic about locomotion. Just mention a little bit about the wiping floor being very good for improving locomotion.
王教授回复说，你可以谈谈这个机制以及任何关于动作能力的学术问题，只要提到一点关于擦地板对改善动作能力是非常好的，这样就行了。
I said I would like to include also the importance of keeping the regular sleep wake rhythm. I wonder how is the sleep wake rhythm of the children in Taiwan?
野村博士回复道，我还想谈谈保持规律作息的重要性。我也很好奇台湾小朋友的作息情况是怎么样的。
Dr. Wan said the problem of late sleep in children is very severe here. It's good to talk about it. So I'm here to discuss with you.
王教授回复说，儿童晚睡的问题在这里非常严重，很值得谈谈这个话题。因此，我来到这里和你们来谈谈这个话题。
As you see here,The discipline of kneeling down to wipe the floor has continued for many years in Japan. This is a photo of 1945, almost 8 years ago.
正如你在这里所看到的，跪下来擦地板的习惯在日本已经延续多年。这是一张1945年的照片，距今已经80年了。
Oh no, somebody is standing with mop.
然而，现在有的小孩却用拖把站着拖地。这是近期的照片。
But look, children are wiping the floor. This is a photo of the recent school in Japan.
但是这些小孩还是弯着腰擦地板。这同样是近期的照片。
Today's my talk includes these things. That number one, development of the brain. Two, importance of the monoamine system, development and disorders.3. Locomotion and higher brain function. 4. Sleep-wake rhythm of developmental disorders. 5. Mechanism of development of locomotion and sleep-wake rhythm. 6. Conclusion.
今天的主题包含了以下六项，分别是大脑的发育以及单胺类系统的重要性、发展与障碍。第三，动作能力以及较高级的脑部功能。以及第四，睡眠觉醒觉力的发展障碍；五，动作能力与睡眠觉醒节律的发展机制；以及最后一个结论。
In this presentation, I will show our data and discuss how the brain of the children mature to the brain of the human being that appreciates the existence of others, society, communication, peace and love.
在今天的演讲中，我将呈现我们的数据。并讨论儿童的大脑如何逐步成熟为成人的大脑，进而拥有能力去欣赏他人、社会、沟通、和平与爱的存在。
This slide shows the development of the brain, how the size and structure develop from the embryo to fetus. Embryo is up to the end of the gestational age, 8 weeks, shown by blue line here. After then, it is called fetus.
这张投影片说明了大脑发育的过程，说明了从胚胎到胎儿阶段的大脑的大小和结构是如何发展的。胚胎阶段一直持续到妊娠的8周末，在图中以蓝线表示，此后则称为胎儿。
This slide shows the brain of a human being. There are 3 7-part, spinal cord, medulla oblongata, pons, cerebellum, midbrain, the encephalon and cerebral hemisphere.
这张投影片说明了人类的大脑总共有7个部分，分别是脊椎、眼脑、桥脑、小脑、中脑、间脑及大脑半球。
This shows how the brain develops, the structure, arrangement, and input pathway to visual, auditory, and language centers are formed by the fetal life of 9 months.The network system to other parts of the brain, particularly to the higher brain, which are responsible for the higher cortical functions, are formed after birth. Both genetic and environmental factors play important roles with critical age.
这张投影片说明了大脑的发育、视觉、听觉和语言中心的结构和输入的途径在胎儿约9个月大时形成。 然而脑部其他部分的网络系统分别是 特别是负责高级皮质功能的部分，却是在出生之后所形成的。遗传和环境的因素在发展的关键时刻都扮演着重要的作用。
The development of the brain manifests as a development of motor, which is milestone, gross movement, and fine motor, and sensory, intellect, and behavior, emotion, and mind.
大脑的发展体现在以下几个方面的发展，分别是动作，可以看到有发展里程碑、粗动作、精细动作，以及感觉、智力、心智、行为、情绪和心理。
This slide shows aminergic neurons in the brainstem and midbrain, serotonergic system, noradrenergic pathways, and dopaminergic pathways.
这张投影片说明的是脑干及中脑的胺类神经元，分别包含血清素神经传导路径、正肾上腺素神经传导路径以及多巴胺类神经传导路径。
This the monoaminergic system. Their cell bodies are in the brainstem and midbrain, local projection and long projection system. These neurons regulate complex function of the central nervous system, such as sleep wakefulness and locomotion and posture. During the development, each has a specific role of maturation of the higher neuronal systems.
这张投影片说明的是单胺类神经系统，细胞体位于脑干或者是中脑，局部神经元的延伸以及长距离的讯息传递系统，这些神经元负责调节中枢神经系统的复杂功能，例如睡眠觉醒、睡眠结构、疼痛感知以及姿势的控制。在发育的过程中，每一个神经元对高阶神经系统的成熟都有着特定的作用。
The function of these neurons are influenced of genetic and environmental factors, serotonergic and noradrenergic system, more environmental system, environmental factors influence more than genetic factors. In contrast, dopaminergic system are more influenced by genetic factors more than environmental factors.
这些神经元的功能受到遗传和环境因素的影响。例如血清素的系统和正肾上腺素的系统负责醒睡周期以及动作能力，主要由环境因素影响，遗传的因素相对较小。而多巴胺系统则是大脑中的奖励系统，主要由遗传因素决定，环境因素影响相对较小。
Monoaminergic neurons, their roles in locomotion and sleep. Evaluation of the neuronal mechanism of developmentalneuropsychological disorders, which have the abnormality of monoaminergic neuron, shows that this system, with a critical age, play important role for the development of the higher neuronal functions. We showed that function of the monoaminergic neurons are reflected particularly in the locomotion and sleep.
单胺类神经元在动作能力和睡眠中的发展，在儿童神经心理疾病机制的研究中发现，在大脑发育的关键时期，单胺类神经元细胞对大脑高级功能的形成非常重要。当这些神经细胞出现问题的时候，可能会导致一些儿童神经和心理方面的疾病。此外，我们也发现单胺类神经元的功能反映在动作能力和睡眠当中。
Locomotion and higher brain function.
动作能力和高阶脑部的功能。
This is early sign of infantile autism. Failure in development of circadian sleep wakefulness by 4 months old, and failure in development of the anti-gravity muscle by 4 months, which induce failure in the development of locomotion, that is crawling and two-pedal walking.
这张投影片说明的是婴儿自闭症的早期现象。在四个月大的时候，睡眠觉醒觉律，也就是昼夜觉律，发育的迟缓，以及四个月大的时候帮助对抗地心引力的肌肉没有正常的发育，会因此导致运动功能发展的困难，影响后续学习爬行和行走的能力。
This shows the walking pattern of autistic patient. Photo A shows walking but no arm swing. Photo B, no arm swing with kicking back of the leg. Photo C shows crawl with ankle dorsiflexed.Photo D is showing good arm swing, but with toe walk.
这张投影片展示的是自闭症儿童的走路样态。首先，图 A 的部分，自闭症的儿童在走路的时候没有手臂的正常摆荡，而 B 图没有大腿的摆荡，而且大腿在走路时呈现一个向后踢的动作。 C 图，自闭症的儿童在爬行时会呈现踝关节背屈的姿势。 D 图，自闭症儿童在走路的时候即使有良好的手臂摆动，也会伴随着脚尖行走。
This shows the crawl in autism. We evaluated patients of autism, 97 cases, and crawling during infancy before 1 year old was observed in 74% and not in almost 26%. Pattern of crawling was evaluated in 72 patients who crawled in infancy, and 47 showed abnormal pattern and only 8% showed normal pattern.
这张投影片说明的是对97例的自闭症患者的爬行评估，有 74.2% 的病人在婴儿的时期发展出爬行行为，剩下的 25.8% 的病人则没有发展出来。接下来，我们对这72名发展出爬行行为的病人进行爬行模式的评估，47.2% 的病人表现出异常的爬行模式，而只有 8% 的病人爬行行为是正常的。
This slide shows the locomotion and IQ or DQ in infantile autism. In horizontal axis shows age tested, and vertical axis shows IQ and DQ. The group who crawled before 12 months are shown in black, and who crawled after 12 months in red.
这张投影片说明的是婴儿时期的自闭症患者的运动能力以及智商发展商数的关系。横轴表示的是测试时的年纪。纵轴表示的是智商以及发展商数。这张投影片告诉我们，12个月以前开始爬行的族群以黑色表示，12个月以后才开始爬行的以红色表示。
The higher scores observed in the group who crawled before 12 months, both groups showed a gradual decrease with the age.
虽然差异并不显著，但在12个月以前开始爬行的族群们观察到较高的分数，而两个群组的分数都随着年龄的增长而逐渐下降。
Next, I will talk about Rett syndrome. Rett syndrome, first described by Andreas Rett in 1966, it is a unique neurodevelopmental disorder.
接下来我将谈谈雷特氏症候群。这是首先由安德烈·雅斯雷特于1966年首先描述的一种症候群。这是一种独特的神经发展障碍。
Age-dependent characteristic of the symptoms include in early infancy postural hypotonia and autistic trait, late infancy failure in locomotion, and thereafter the characteristic symptom continues.
这是一种独特的神经发育障碍，具有跟年龄相关的症状特征。在早期的婴儿时期，主要以知识性低张力以及自闭特征来表现。而在婴儿的晚期则会出现动作能力的发展迟滞。
This is a locomotion of Rett syndrome. Photo A shows flexed fingers and ankle, and the girl cannot move forward. Photo B shows by rolling the trunk, the child can move forward, but with flexed fingers. Photo C shows by swinging the body side to side, the child can move forward. Photo D is showing toe walk is observed sometimes in Rett syndrome, which is often observed in autism.
这张投影片说明的是雷特氏症候群的动作能力。图 A 显示的是雷特氏症候群的病人在爬行时，手指及脚踝会呈现弯曲的状态，并且无法向前移动。而图 B 表示的是这些孩子会借由摇摆滚动的方式来向前移动。此时他们的手指依然呈现弯曲的状态，而图 C 则是借由身体的左右摆动，这些孩子可以向前移动，而图 D 则是可以看到有时候他们也会观察到以脚尖行走的步态，这在自闭症的孩童中也常常被观察到。
Here is a Rett syndrome, the motor milestone versus word. 100 cases of Rett syndrome were studied for their age when the milestone was achieved, and 6 cases of 100 showed the word, but 40 had never developed the word as shown in the block.
雷特氏症候群的语言发展和动作能力的关系在这张投影片中被展示，总共分析了100例的雷特氏症候群的患者达到里程碑的年龄，有60例的病人发展出语言能力的族群以红色表示，有40例从未发展出语言能力的病人则以黑色来表示。
Here horizontal line shows a milestone and vertical line shows the age when each milestone was achieved。
横轴显示的是各个里程碑，而纵轴显示的则是达到各个里程碑的年龄。
Head control was achieved at 3 months with both groups and rolling over was at 7 months in both groups, sitting at 8 months with the word plus group, but 11 months, which is delayed in the word minus group.
由语言发展的组别以加号来表示在3个月的时候发展出头部控制的能力，而没有语言发展的组别则以减号来表示在5个月大的时候就有达到头部控制的能力。这两个组别在7个月时都可以做到翻身的动作，然而有语言发展的组别在8个月大的时候发展出坐的能力，然而无语言发展的组别则延迟到11个月才达到坐立的姿势。
Significant differences observed with both crawling and walking.The patient with the word achieved crawling normally at 11 months of age. In contrast, the crawling delayed to 1 year 7 months with a patient who did not have the word.
而在爬行和行走能力也观察到显著的差异。有语言发展的患者通常在11个月大的时候可以爬行，相比之下，没有语言发展的病人爬行则延迟到1岁7个月大。
Similarly, significant differences were observed in walking.That is, patient with a word walked at 1 year 7 months of age with a slight delay, but the patient who did not have the word walked at 2 years 8 months of age.
同样，在行走方面也观察到显著的差异。即使有语言发展的患者在1岁7个月大的时候开始行走，只有轻微的延迟，但没有语言发展的病人则直到2岁5个月大的时候才开始行走。
The findings suggest that locomotion, that is crawling and walking, relate to the development of higher brain function.
这些发现表示了运动能力，也就是爬行和行走的能力，与高级的脑功能发展有关。
Sleep wakefulness of developmental disorders.
发展障碍与睡眠觉醒节律的关系。
Keeping the sleep diary gives important information regarding the sleep wakefulness.
记录睡眠日记是提供了关于睡眠觉醒觉律的一些重要讯息。
One day is 24 hours, but the biological clock runs a little longer, so we have to adjust the brain to 24 hours. To do this, sunlight, regular meal time, and enhancing the activity during the daytime is essential.
一天有24小时，但生物时钟的运行则稍长一些，因此我们必须将大脑调整到24小时的节奏。为了达到这个目的，阳光以及规律的用餐时间以及增加白天的活动是非常重要的。
We ask the mothers to keep this sleep diary. A horizontal line indicates the 24 hours. Black bar shows the person in a sleepAnd white bar indicates the person is awake. In the next slide, I will show the result.
我们请病人的母亲帮助记录睡眠的日记。一条水平线代表的是一整天，也就是24个小时。黑色的条状部分表示人在睡眠，白色的条状则表示人是清醒的。在接下来的投影片当中，我将说明我们的结果。
This is the sleep wakefulness of autism.As you see here, the patient goes to sleep very late, even after midnight, and wake up late, often around the noon. The circle area showed the free running pattern, indicating biological clock, not 24 hours rhythm, but 25 or 26 hours.
这张投影片说明的是自闭症病人的醒睡节律。就如您所见，这些病人很晚入睡，甚至在午夜之后才入睡，并且经常在中午左右才醒来。 圆圈标记的区域显示了自由运行模式，表示这不是生物钟的节律，也非24小时的节律。
The left column is sleep rhythm of the autism. The right is the age-matched normal control. As written in the red, daytime environmental stimulation decreases the daytime sleep and normalizes the 24-hour sleep rhythm.
左蓝是自闭症病人的睡眠觉醒节律，右蓝则是年龄相符的正常对照组，如红色字体所写。白天的环境刺激减少了白天的睡眠，使得24小时的睡眠觉醒觉律正常化。
In addition to daytime environmental stimulation, oral administration of 5-HTP, which is precursor of serotonin, further normalizes sleep echolism.
除了白天的环境刺激之外，口服 5-HTP, 一种血清素的前驱物，也可以进一步使得睡眠觉醒正常化。
The abnormal awakening during sleep improved by the administration of a small dose of L-DOPA. At the same time, behavior such as understanding words, self-mutilation, and hitting others also improved.
通过服用低剂量的 L-DOPA, 也就是左旋多巴，睡眠中异常醒来的情况也能够得到改善。此外，有一些行为的问题，像是单字、词语的理解、自残和打人也都有所改善。
This is sleep echolism of Rett syndrome.
这是自雷特氏症候群的睡眠觉醒觉律。
Left fear is a result of sleep diary. The light shows the total hours of the sleep during the night, circled in blue, and daytime circled in red against the age of patient.
左图是睡眠日记的结果，右图显示的是患者在不同年龄段的夜间睡眠总时间，以蓝色的圆圈表示，和白天睡眠的总时间以红色的圆圈表示。
As you see here, nighttime sleep is around 10 hours in all ages. In contrast, daytime sleep normally decreases as the child gets older. However, in Rett syndrome, patients slept during the daytime, even after 5 years old, when normally daytime sleep disappears.
这张图片看到的是所有年龄段的夜间睡眠时间都是大概10个小时，在正常的情况下，随着孩子年龄的增加，白天的睡眠时间会逐渐的减少。然而雷特氏症候群的患者即使在5岁之后仍然会存在白天的睡眠，而在这个年龄段正常的情况下的白天睡眠都已经消失。
Tourette syndrome patient also shows abnormal sleep echolism.This is the two cases complain that they cannot go to sleep and cannot wake up.
妥瑞症患者也表现出异常的醒睡节律。这些14岁6个月大以及17岁5个月大的患者常常抱怨难以入睡，也很难醒来。
The sleep echolism of Tourette syndrome can improve by giving the good instruction.
但是通过给予指导，妥瑞症患者的醒睡节律也可以得到改善。
Next, I will talk about the mechanism of development of locomotion.
接下来我将谈一谈动作能力的发展。
This shows the change of posture, which is standing, crawling and standing and walking through life.
这张图片展示的是从姿势、站立和行走能力在生命历程中的变化。
And in addition to reciprocal movement extremities, it is important to keep the good posture.
除了四肢的交替运动之外，保持良好的姿势也很重要。
This shows the development of locomotion. First, crawling at age 7 to 8 months, and walk with support 10 to 11 months, and walk without support 1 year to 1.2 months.
这张图片展示的是动作能力的发展。首先在7到8个月的时候会发展出爬行能力，首先会使用肘部爬行，接下来肚子离地爬行，以及用手和膝盖的爬行，也就是正常的爬行状态。在10到11个月的时候，走路的时候还需要支撑，但在1岁到1岁2个月时就已经可以独立行走了。
This slide shows the crawling pattern of infancy. The pattern C is normal, that's allowed, with lead alone, that showing the dorsal surface of the foot is on the floor.
这张图片展示的是婴儿的爬行形态，就如红箭头所指的 C 模式是正常的，脚背的部分接触地面。
Locomotion that is reciprocal movement of extremities is controlled by the specific neuronal systems, including spinal cord, brainstem, and higher neuronal trunk systems.
运动，也就是四肢的交替运动，受到特定的神经系统控制，包括脊椎、脑干以及更高级的神经系统。
Serotonergic and noradrenergic system works at spinal cord and brainstem.In contrast, dopaminergic system works at basal ganglia and higher system.
血清素能够跟去甲基的肾上腺素系统在脊髓和脑干起了作用，多巴胺的神经系统则是在基底神经节和更高级的系统中起的作用。
The mechanism of development of sleep echolism.
接下来要说明的是醒睡节律的发展。
Upper part indicate how the rhythm develop during infancy.
这张图的上半部显示的是婴儿时期的节律是如何发展的。
From ultradian rhythm, free running rhythm to circadian rhythm when synchronized to daytime, day and night sleep rhythm.
首先发展的是从超昼夜的节律到自由运行的节律，再到昼夜节律，最终与日夜节律同步。
Lower part indicate the total night sleepremain almost the same, but total daytime sleep decrease against the age.
这张图的下半部显示的是总夜间睡眠时间几乎保持不变，但总日间睡眠的时间会随着年龄的增加而减少。
This slide shows the development of sleep echolism in normal children.
这张图片说明的是正常儿童的睡眠觉醒节律的发展。
This indicates how the sleep echolism develops. Baby sleeps through the day. With the development, the baby learns to wake up during the daytime.
这说明了睡眠觉醒的节律是如何发展的。婴儿整天都在睡觉，然而随着发育，婴儿会学会在白天的时候保持清醒。
Circadian rhythm develops around 4 months of age. Then daytime sleep takes the form of nap.
昼夜节律的发展约在四个月大的时候开始发展起来，之后白天的睡眠会逐渐转变为中午午睡的形式。
Nap 2 times a day at 7 to 8 months of age, and then once in PM at 1 year, 2 and 3 months of age.
在7到8个月大的时候，每天会午睡两次，但到了1岁2到3个月大的时候，每天下午则会午睡一次。
At around 4 to 5 years of age, the daytime sleep disappears, forming the biphasic sleep echolism.
在大约4到5岁的时候，白天的睡眠会消失，形成了双向的睡眠觉醒节律。
This sleep echolism is very interesting case with a free running rhythm seen in a case with agenesis of corpus callosum.
在这里，我提出一个非常有趣的案例。这是一个胼胝体没有发育的病例，在他的身上，我观察到了睡眠的模式以自由运行的节律来表示。
This patient first visited the clinic at age of 4 months with a complaint of developmental delay.
这位患者在4个月大的时候首次就诊，主诉为发育迟缓。
She was blind with atrophy of the optic nerve.
因为视神经萎缩，他是一位盲人。
Imaging shows agenesis of corpus callosum.
影像的检查显示了他的胼胝体没有发育。
Sleep echolism abnormality was noticed at age of 4 to 5 months of age.
这位病人在4到5个月大的时候发现有睡眠觉醒的异常。
Because of the atrophy of the optic nerve, the sunlight could not get into the brain.
由于视神经的萎缩，他的阳光没有办法进入他的大脑。
Agenesis of corpus callosum is a malformation of the brain, missing the fibers connecting the both cortices.
胼胝体的缺失是一种畸形，这样的畸形可能涉及其他中线结构的异常。
This midline malformation may involve other midline structures such as serotonergic and noradrenergic systems.
中线系统的发育异常可能包含其他血清素以及多巴胺系统发育的异常。
The sleep wakefulness rhythm is abnormalities observed in different environment. In the left side shows the patient, the child living in suburb area and right child living in urban area.
睡眠觉醒的觉率在这张图中被展示，我们可以看到睡眠的比例和居住的区域也是有非常大的相关性。左例是居住在郊区的案例，而右例则是居住在都市的案例。
So beta rhythm in the surrounding of suburb with better environment.
郊区会有较好的睡眠品质。
So conclusion, keeping the normal sleep mechanism from infancy leads to development of language, emotion, and intellect.
最后在结论的部分，从婴儿时期开始保持正常的睡醒节律可以促进语言、情感和智力的发展。
So keeping the locomotion that is crawling in infancy and walking in upright posture in toddler age lead to human brain with mind with better higher function theory of mind.
保持动作能力，也就是婴儿的时候爬行，幼儿的时候直立行走，可以促进人类大脑和心智的发展。
So these findings are important for the nurture and education not only of the children with developmental disorders but also of the children with normal development.
这些发现不仅对发育障碍的儿童的培养和教育很重要，而且也对发育正常的儿童来说非常重要。
So watch, children are kneeling down to wipe the floor.
你们看，四肢的协调运动是很重要的。
The reciprocal movement of the extremities are very important for the development of the brain.
这些四肢的协调运动对于大脑的发展来说非常重要。
So development of the child is supported by multidisciplinary approaches.
儿童的发展需要各领域不同专科的专家们共同努力。
Child neurology and child care nurturing education and development support therapeutic rehabilitation.
这当中包含了小儿神经学、育儿、保育、教育以及疗愈的部分。
The children in peace, peace in the world. This is the motto of my clinic.
这是我的诊所的座右铭。儿童安康，世界和平。
Today's presentation is based on the studies by my mentor Dr. Masaya Segawa and myself at Segawa Neurological Clinic for Children and continued by myself at Yoshiko Nomura Neurological Clinic for Children.
今天的演讲基于我的导师赖春川野在博士和我自己在赖川儿童神经科病院的研究，并由我本人野村佳子继续在野村佳子儿童神经科病院继续进行。
Thank you and Shasha, ありがとうございました。
谢谢你们。
I have to add thank you, Dr. Tang,
for the translation.
谢谢唐医师帮我们及时的翻译。Thank you, Dr. Nomura, for your excellent talk. 有听众有要提问哈、
哦、？Yes, is it okay for me to ask? Actually, just to make a comment.I'm referring to the slide for development of child, and there are three circles. And you mentioned that a full development of child includes, or they need experts from child neurology or child care and developmental support. I really want to add, we should actually include the whole society, the way how we understand the disability, the way how we understand children and their relationships with their mothers or parents or teachers. All these interpersonal relationships actually would contribute a lot more to our development of child. That's my comment.
Thank you very much for your nice comment. Yes, of course, the family is the best thing, part which would be involved. Is that the mom?
家庭的支持当然是最重要的。好，那这个其实也是当前台湾社会或是很多地方的社会的一个问题了哈，家庭的状况急剧的在变化哦，那大家庭不见了，小家庭，那小家庭常常有一些不懂得怎么带小孩的 父母啊，或是不小心当了父母的，所以问题很大，好，所以才需要大家一起来努力。那有没有其他的问题？
I'd like to know if you could share your experience of how Japanese government incorporate all this into the health system. I think the Taiwanese national health insurance is trying to extend our pediatric care, especially working into the developmental session or to early intervention. So, as you mentioned here in the three or the other audience mentioned, might be four circles. In Japan, how do you incorporate all these factors?
It's a very good point. And we are also trying to do that collaborative work. But sometimes it doesn't work well. But still, I think that's the most important part, the collaboration with these specialties and also families, children. And we are trying, but as you pointed out, maybe in some sort could be difficult, but that would be the goal.
From clinic observation, we may experience some children, they lost the period of crying period. They just from sitting and walk and stand up. They don't crawl. But finally, they have a normal development. So do you encourage these children when they are from sitting to standing? They don't have crying. How do you, what is your opinion? That the mother and the parents have anxiety, or they lost the crying ability? Thank you.
I see many children with developmental disorders, autistic and some other different. And I always ask if they crawled or not, age they crawled. And then also pattern, I ask the mother those patterns. And then I went go on usually and ask the behavior, how the behavior changes. And I often experience that this crawling pattern, normal crawling pattern, is related to the later emotion, development of emotion and behavior. And I think that is an important point, that crawling is controlled by the serotonergic and noradrenergic system, which is important system developed during the infancy. And if that part is developed normally, the later behavior seems to be better. So, and then I encourage the mothers, I encourage the mothers and children that do the try bicycle or do the swimming, moving the extremities, coordinated movement, to develop the coordinated movement normally.
就是说，也是有些小孩子好像也没经过爬行，但后来也很正常。但是问题，表面正常是不是真的正常？我可能要夸张一点讲哦，这个世界好像越来越乱，可能跟没有爬行有关系啊。很多看起来很正常的在当总统的，我说做出一些奇奇怪怪的决定哦。那有一个可能将来会在监狱里边当总统也说不定哈。所以为什么这个世界越来越乱？说不定这也是其中一个 factor 了。哦，当然有人好像没有经过爬行也后来也活得不错，可是。他是活得不错，可是周围的人可能活得不太好哈，会被他霸凌啊，会被他欺负哈，所以这问题是相对的。所以虽然好像有的人说没有经过爬行，好像没事，但是我觉得没事不是没事，不是真的没事，没事才是有事哈，就是，假装天下太平，那其实很不太平。还有没有其他的问题？
I'm really interested in your perspective on the crawling versus locomotion. So I would define locomotion as any way to move across the room, regardless of whether that's crawling or walking. And in the data that you showed was quite correlational. So looking at if you crawl, it's correlated with things versus causation. Can you talk a little bit about your interpretation of if it's moving and the ability to move yourself versus does it have to be crawling or walking? So a child who has to use a wheelchair but can do so independently, we see some of the same improvements in their development in other domains.
That is a good point, which I did not touch on it. But what I was already mainly focusing on the locomotion, which is influenced by the brainstem serotonergic, noradrenergic. This system not only sends the projection to the upper part, they send the projection to the spinal cord, so the locomotion center. So that was only focusing. You mentioned about the movement altogether, but such as the one in the wheelchair, I think that is another good point. Maybe to encourage the movement is encourage the dopaminergic system, not that serotonergic and noradrenergic. So I think that what your point is very well taken, and that is, I would next include that part. Thank you very much.
爬行的能力是由中枢系统当中的脑干当中的血清素系统以及多巴胺系统，他们会伸出长长的神经元突触到大脑的皮质。此外，他们也会伸出长长的突触到脊椎的神经系统当中。因此，爬行的能力能够透过这些神经系统去刺激血清素以及多巴胺的分泌，借此来影响大脑皮质的高级功能。因此，爬行的能力是与大脑的发展有非常重要的关系的。
有吗？也可以问头类的问题哦。Dr. Nomura 也是头类的专家，我是去跟他学的。我有一年去日本，在东京哦，那交通很乱，我的 orientation 不太好，我找不到。然后我怎么后来会找得到？因为看到前面有一个头类的病人，我就跟着他走，就到了。
不好意思，我想问一下，就是关于那个醒睡节律啊，然后如果再给家长意见，就是要怎么样调整孩子的睡眠，除了就是服用口服的药物之外，是会给家长就是建议说日常的运动或者是什么方面的建议？
That is another point, important point. Because many children with these problems, their sleep pattern is very irregular. So first, we have to say, you know, before giving some medication, we have to adjust our daily life. You have to get up early and go to bed without smartphone or game before going to bed. And then we encourage them to have 3 good meals, morning and breakfast and lunch and dinner at certain time, not too late, too early. And also I encourage they should be active during daytime with friend and school also sometimes. This is kind of the thing I give as an instruction.
睡眠的问题是很严重的哈。那那个教授有时候就是要规律的，那要提到有一个就是
保持。这个问题在台湾同样非常在这个问题在儿童当中非常的普遍。那我会请他们的父母要保持良好的睡眠习惯，包含在睡觉之前不要用 3C 的产品，例如手机，以及保持固定的用餐的规律的作息，还有就是不要在白天的时候多活动。那这样子的话，告诉他们这些先在药物之前先使用这样子的方式，来提醒他们有一个良好的作息习惯，来保持规律的睡眠。
还要加一点，很多小孩啊躺在床上睡不着，在那边翻来覆去，我都叫他们下床去擦地板，擦完累昏了就会睡着了。哦，这个因为时间到了，所以我们就 close 这个 section 哈。Thank you, Dr. Nomura. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.